Welcome to a very special peak performance here in the Gibson showroom, a really cool room, with the great Frank Turner.
Hello.
He's got a new Gibson.
I do.
And he's excited about it, and he's going to break it in. It's going to be a lot of
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, I literally have owned this guitar, and it's mine. It's mine.
It's his. It's not a loaner.
For about 20 minutes now.
Awesome.
And I'm very excited about it because it's a very nice antique J45.
Well, let's hope you get some good sounds out of it. I think you can.
I believe so.
Cool. So let's jump right into a song.
All right. Well, this is a song. I'm an Englishman, which means I'm congenitally predisposed to talk about the weather.
Yes.
And I thought I'd try and kind of cut to the chase and just write a song about it instead so we could just get that out of my system at the start of the interview.
So no problem.
This song's called The Next Storm. We had a difficult winter, we had a rough few months. When the storms came in off the coast, it felt like they broke everything on us at once. But it's easy enough to talk about blitz spirit when you're on a hole in the roof, up and knee deep in it. But the pictures and the papers got ruined by the rain, and we wondered if they'd ever get dry again. But I don't want to spend the whole of my life indoors, laying low, waiting on the next storm. I don't want to spend the whole of my life inside. I want to step out and face the sunshine. We lost faith in the omens, we lost faith in the gods. We just ended up clutching at the empty rituals like gamblers clutching long odds. But I don't care what the weatherman is saying, because the last time that I saw him, he was on his knees, he was praying. The preachers and the scientists got soaked just the same. We wondered if they'd ever get dry again. I don't want to spend the whole of my life indoors, laying low, waiting on the next storm. I don't want to spend the whole of my life inside. I want to step out and face the sunshine. So open the shutters, raise up the mast, rejoice, rebuild, the storm has passed. Cast off the crutches, cut up the cast, rejoice, rebuild, the storm has passed. Rejoice, rebuild, the storm has passed. Spend the whole of my life inside, laying low, waiting on the next storm. I don't want to spend the whole of my life inside. I want to step out and face the sunshine. I'm not gonna live the whole of my life indoors. Gonna step out and face the next storm.
Frank Turner, Next Storm.
Thank you.
The song you heard first on 107.1 The Peak, the song we're playing. It's off your latest album, Positive Songs for Negative People. I don't want to screw that up. I don't want to say negative songs for positive people.
Well, that might be the next record.
That may be the next one.
It'll be a grindcore record.
Yeah, and I have to say, it kind of fits the album because some may say, from time to time, I can be a negative person.
Yeah.
The other day, I popped the album in. I was like, yeah, you know what? I feel kind of better about myself.
Okay, excellent. Well, it's a funny thing. I mean, you know, I like the title. It's not supposed to be quite as po-faced as some people have taken it to be. I was doing a bunch of interviews in Germany, and God bless the Germans. They are lovely, but they do take everything very literally.
Yes. And they're very serious people.
Yeah, and he was like, so you think that all of your fans are the negative people, yeah? And I was like, no, it's not quite
how I'm
coming at this.
You know, it's, yeah.
But, you know, everyone has their bad days. But I did a whole record about having a bad day, essentially. Tape Deck Heart was a record about
breakup and about failure and about things falling apart. And this is the kind of the rebound album.
Right.
That's so not quite what I mean at all.
I know what you mean. Like,
yeah,
the,
it's kind of just picking yourself back up.
Pick yourself back up. And that the song Next Storm kind of describes something like that. You've been through something and now you're ready to move on.
Definitely. I mean, that was kind of the vibe, you know. I had, actually, funnily enough, with that song, I had this, I was absolutely convinced there was a scene at the end of Wizard of Oz where they come out of a storm shelter and the town's been destroyed, and that's what the song's about. And then I watched the film again to check that I hadn't made this up, and it turns out I completely had.
I was just thinking about that. I was like,
that's
remember,
not in the film at all. So it's about an imaginary scene from The Wizard of Oz.
It should be, Frank.
Well, let's remake it right now, me and you. I'll play Dorothy.
That's right. So you're in New York doing three shows in New York. Now, do you ever stop touring? Because I looked at your tour page, and it seems, do you realize you have two shows on Saturday?
Like,
yeah,
I had two shows yesterday as well.
Two shows yesterday.
Technically four shows in New York in three days.
Goodness.
So, you know, I do. I mean, actually, funnily enough, the birth of this album had some difficult moments to do with kind of trying to figure out the right way of coming at it and this kind of thing. And I ended up with a few months actually off the road. And it was a weird time for me. I realized it was the longest time I'd had off tour since I was 19.
Wow.
And I'm 33 now. And it
That's
was weird.
A long time,
I figured, I realized I don't.
It's half a lifetime ago.
Yeah, I don't really know how to adult. In one place. And everything, things got pretty kind of shady for a while. I was kind of like drinking too much and that kind of thing.
Yeah, just didn't know what to do with yourself almost.
Yeah, quite. And it was just kind of like, I was like, I've got two options. Either I need to learn how to be a grown-up or I could go back on tour again. So I'm on tour again.
So you're on tour again. Yeah. And you're on tour for the foreseeable future.
How
do you do two shows in one day? Aren't you exhausted by the end of the day?
Yeah, it's a tiring day. And I mean, I'm a little croaky today, as you can hear as a result.
See.
But I mean, you know. It's funny, like, I'm going to say this without mentioning names and without trying to cast aspersions on anyone particularly, but, like, I'm mystified when you meet people who are professional musicians who seem to resent the playing music part of it, you know?
Right.
I'm enjoying our chat, it's great, but it's, like, all of the kind of, like, the travel and the press and the admin and all that kind of thing is necessary, just stuff to do, and I was going to say necessary evil, but that's not quite what I mean.
It's okay.
You know, you just get through it in order so that you can play.
Yeah, right.
And that's the bit that I like, and it's sort of weird to me that there are. I've encountered many bands who seem to find the playing bit tiresome.
Just annoyed by the gig.
Yeah, and it's kind of like, surely that's the only bit that you should be like super into.
Right. Yeah, you would think. Yeah.
I mean, I'm a musician.
But doesn't it get tiring after a while playing kind of the same songs all over? I know you switched up. You do cover songs in different cities and that kind of thing.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I've got six albums worth of material, not including B-sides now, and
so you can mix it up a little.
Yeah,
bit.
You know, so I mean, actually we played a very different set last night in New York for the second show of three, and it was fun, and we played a bunch of stuff we haven't played in a long time, although it was quite weird because I kept forgetting what on earth was coming next in the set list. And we're usually quite slick at banging, me and my band, we're usually quite slick at banging from one song to the next. And last night it was like, finished song, and it was like, oh my God, I have no idea.
But that can be kind of fun in a way too, right?
Yeah, I mean, it was fun. I think the crowd enjoyed it.
Great. Well, how about another song?
Yes, another song. Well, I'm going to put a capo on my guitar, which
capo
is a
on the guitar,
fantastic tool for
the
convincing
first
people.
Capo on the brand new guitar.
Yes, it's a great tool for convincing people that you know more chords than you actually do, because it makes everything sound different.
Yeah.
The next song I'm going to play is a song I wrote for my cousin, who is more like a little sister to me, and she had a really bad year, and not through any fault of her own. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to make her feel better, so I wrote a song. I mean, that's not the only thing I did, obviously.
Right.
I also kind of, you know, helped out in practical
ways. You did other stuff, too.
I bought her a drink.
Writing the songs also.
But this song was her. This song's called Glorious You. Now I can see you hurting beneath your new red dress, beneath your sharp new shoes and your new tattoos, you are directionless. And I know you've been working as hard as you can to preempt the question, the expectation, and I understand. So come on now, if we all pull together, lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Just for
moment the phone alarm cuts the morning in two, to the moment you close your bedroom door and all that's left is you. There were a thousand auditions you didn't quite get through, so many masks to wear, so much weight to bear, but you were only ever you. You were glorious, you. You were glorious. Come on now, if we all pull together, we can lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Come on now, if we all pull together, we can lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders, just for a moment or two, and be glorious you, glorious you, glorious you. With your mixed up metaphors and your messed up makeup, you're glorious you. With your tongue-tied tragedy and your two small t-shirts, you're glorious you. So don't you worry, all things must end. There are sunlit up lands around the river bend. Come on now, if we all pull together, we could lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders, just for a moment or two. Come on now, if we all pull together, we could lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders. Lift up the weight of the world from your shoulders, just for a moment or two. Be glorious you, glorious you, glorious you. You were glorious you, you were glorious you, you were glorious you.
Glorious You, a song that can be found on the new album.
Yes.
Positive songs for negative people. I always have to say that slowly so that I get it right. I don't want to mix that up. So I don't know if you remember, but you probably don't, but a couple of years ago, we did a similar one of these with myself and you.
I was going to say that we've crossed paths.
I probably look a little familiar, but I probably gained a considerable amount of weight. So it's okay if you don't recognize me. Shortly after that, I want to say a few weeks later, I think you got in a really bad accident and you hurt your back.
Oh yeah, well yeah, okay, yes.
That was.
I mean, it wasn't quite so much kind of like an accident kind of thing. It came on slowly. I jumped off a drum on a drum riser, quite a high drum riser in Bonnaroo Festival in Manchester, Tennessee, which looked fantastic at the time.
I hope you got a clip of that on YouTube.
Yeah, there is a photo somewhere, and it looks great. But I landed a little awkwardly, and then carried on, and just kind of was a bit. Afterwards, and then basically it just kind of got worse and worse day on day for about 2 months until I couldn't walk anymore.
Yeah, because I remember I saw you live at Terminal 5, I think it was maybe the night before Thanksgiving, I want to say,
and
you couldn't play. I couldn't tell anything was wrong with you other than the fact that you couldn't really play the guitar.
I had this kind of crisis moment when my back sort of totally just kind of went nope, it happened to be 10 days before playing like Two Down from Headliner on the Reading and Leeds festivals in the UK, which is like the biggest thing ever.
Right.
And then immediately after that, we were going off on like a 4 month world tour. And I went to see a doctor and he was like, don't panic, it's okay. I've definitely seen worse than this. We're going to fix you up. You're going to be fine. All you got to do is cancel whatever you're doing for the next like 3-4 months and you're going to be fine.
Oh, yeah.
And I just said, nope.
You don't operate that way.
Yeah, no. We had a long chat about it and we put together the schedule. I had a sort of steroid injection in my spine and he gave me like 3 times the recommended dose. And he was like, this will definitely get you up on your feet.
Did it work?
It did. I mean, I was walking around shortly afterwards.
That steroids is some good stuff. I got to get a little bit of that. Just a little bit of the juice, I feel.
It was great.
Right,
pretty roid ragey for a little time. That was fun. and then like basically, we did this tour and my wonderful guitar tech, Kiaher, who has seen me play, you know, the set or the songs that I play for many years from the side of stage, and is a great guitar player himself. I called him up and I said, "Do you fancy playing guitar at Reading and Leeds festivals?" And he said, "Holy Christ!"
Yeah, that's the guy I saw. I think.
Yeah. So and by that point he was very well practiced and well oiled. Yeah. But his first gig in the band was in front of like 80,000 people.
Yeah, that's
so he was a little nervous about that, but he did a great job. But yeah, and then I was doing like 3-4 hours of physiotherapy on the road every day, which I can tell you now is boring.
Yeah, I would imagine. Did you write any songs during that time? Or?
No, I listened to a lot of kind of metal, mostly, actually.
Get that anger out.
Yeah, I like totally. It. I was just kind of knee-deep in kind of Slayer. It was good.
Nice. Knee-deep in Slayer. That's always good.
That's the title of the next album.
Knee-deep in Slayer. Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah. Now, it looks like, do you have some new tattoos? Looks like you got some new tattoos, too.
I'm kind of coloring in slowly but surely.
Are you going to go with the full sleeve at some point?
Well, I'm not really. I'm almost keen on the kind of like the sleeve as the whole kind of like one piece that covers the whole thing. I'd always... becomes a little indistinct to me. I've got lots of little bits.
I see what you're saying.
That.
You
Each
can still tell that they're different. I like it. My mom would kill me if I got a tattoo, so I
well,
do that.
You could get one somewhere secret.
Oh, that's, you know what? That's
you got your
true.
Inside lip done.
Oh, that's hardcore. I like it.
Yeah.
What does
and
it say?
It says thirsty. It's in case I'm too drunk to talk to the bartender. but like,
that's great.
Basically, you can't, even a nearest and dearest wouldn't spot this unless you chose to show
that's
it.
True, unless you just chose to show it to him.
Yeah, it's extremely unpleasant getting it done, though.
Well, then I'll think about it.
Okay.
I'll think about that. How about one more song?
Okay, yes, cool. This is a song about... this is a song from a previous record. There's a story behind this. I went to Australia for the first time a few years ago, and I was on hiatus, should we say, from the girl I was seeing at the time.
Right. We're on a break.
Yes, on a break, which is kind of what became the subject of the next record. But... I met a koala for the first time, which I'm very excited about because koalas are obviously cool.
Yeah, right.
And koalas eat eucalyptus exclusively. And I was I'd sort of gone about this, and I was standing in a room, and they brought a koala out and put it on me. And my ex-girlfriend uses eucalyptus-scented shampoo. And my kind of moment of community with a koala was slightly interrupted by the thought. It was like, man, have you been seeing my ex? Like, what's going
That's
on here?
That's funny.
And that may or may not have impacted the writing of this.
Interesting.
So,
right.
This song is called The Way I Tend to Be. Some mornings pray for evening, for the day to be done. Some summer days I hide away and wait for rain to come. As it turns out, hell will not be found in the fires below, making do and muddling through when you know where else to go. And then I remember you, and the way you shine like truth in all you do. And if you remember save me from the way I tend to be, way I tend to be. Some days I wake up days, my dear, and don't know where I am. I've been running now so long, I'm scared, forgotten how to stand. And stand around in airport bars, gather thoughts to think. If all I have was one long road, drive a man's drink. Then I remember you, and the way you shine like truth in all you do. And if you remember, save me from the way I tend to be. Cause I said I love you so many times that the words kinda die in my mouth. And I meant it each time with these beautiful women, but somehow it never works out. But you stood apart in my callous heart and you taught me, and here's what I learned. That love is about all the changes you make, not just three small words. Then I catch myself catching your scent on someone else in a crowded space, and it takes me somewhere I cannot quite place. And then I remember you and the way you shine like truth in all you do. But if you remember me, you could save me from the way I tend to be, the way I tend to be. The way I tend to be, the way I tend to be.
Frank Turner, The Way I Tend to Be. That's off the previous album, Tape Deck Heart. The current album, Positive Songs for Negative People, is out there right now, wherever it is you buy music these days.
Yes, indeed. Record stores, hopefully.
If you could find one.
Yeah, well, I was in Rough Trade Records yesterday.
What a wonderful place it is, too. That's right. Real quick, I just got to ask you about your music video situation. I just saw the video for Josephine.
Yes.
Attractive woman, completely naked, covered in some sort of ink, and then they dumped the ink on you.
Yes, she was actually wearing underwear, I'm pleased to say.
Listen, I don't want to start anything.
Might have been a little R-rated otherwise.
Did they actually have to dump the paint on you?
Yes, they did. It was horrible. I had a terrible, terrible hangover.
Sounds really bad.
The day that we were shooting the video, and it was 10 gallons of freezing cold black paint.
I had this idea
that maybe it was going to kind of like clear up my hangover, and it totally didn't.
No, it does look kind of cool though.
It looks really cool. But it took me, and then the other thing is, I spent about 2 hours in the shower immediately after the shoot, and came out looking like a goth essentially, because it was like still around my eyes and like in my ears.
Yeah,
and stuff.
Wow.
So I looked quite weird for a few days.
It's a cool video, and the other video I got to ask you about. Most of the people in our audience probably won't know what I'm talking about, but I'm a personal fan of CM Punk.
Yes, CM Punk.
And you are the man who got CM Punk back into the wrestling ring.
I did.
For those of you who don't know, CM Punk is the former world champion of the WWE who quit pretty much at the top of his game.
He did, and he's now training for UFC.
Screw you. And now he's training to be a real UFC fighter.
Yeah, which is crazy.
Which is crazy, and he looks great. He hasn't really done much since he left the wrestling ring, but he did. How did that come about?
He's been doing tons and tons of training.
Yeah.
But yeah, but I mean, basically, we just sort of found out he's a friend of a friend, and we found out that he's a fan, and we just sort of got his email address and sent him an email.
That's
and
awesome.
Said, "Do you want to be in a video?" And he said, "Yeah,
why cool."
So the video is him kind of beating me up for some time.
Yes.
And then I spoiler alert, I win.
That's right. That's right.
It wasn't staged in any way. It was a really quite intimidating process.
He seems like a pretty intimidating guy. Not that he's the biggest guy.
Yeah,
he just seems like a guy you don't want to mess with.
In the build-up for the shoot, I was like doing press ups and stuff, and thinking like I'm gonna like try and bulk up a little bit, and I was feeling quite good about myself. And then we both took our shirts off on the video shoot, and I was like, might as well not bother with this.
And compared to the other wrestlers, he's like the little guy too. That's the scary part.
Yeah, well, true.
You know what I mean?
He's still extremely intimidating,
big and extremely intimidating,
but very nice and very gentle. He didn't actually break me in half, which he could have done.
That's good, right? Well, nobody really knows what we're talking about, so we'll just not people in our audience.
I can see people behind camera getting very excited.
I just had to find out how you got CM Punk to do that video. So we will wrap things up with Frank Turner. Thanks for the performance today.
Thank you for having
me. It's a very special room, the Gibson Showroom. Thanks to everybody here at Gibson. Thanks to Tracy and his staff and everybody here for setting up the cameras and everything. Frank Turner, go get that record, Positive Songs for Negative People. That's it on 107.1 The Peak.